on these three pillars. They are known as Sila, Samadhi, and Panya. Meaning, Sila, morals, discipline, precept, and moral conduct. Samadhi, mental training, mental development, the peace, the calm, tranquility, the mind experience. Panya, supreme wisdom. It is not knowledge. By using the knowledge that we have gathered during our lifetime, we use that knowledge unbiasedly. Always we use the knowledge biasedly. Then there is no wisdom. When we use the knowledge biasedly, by reducing evil forces from the mind, when we use our knowledge, if our anger or jealousy or enmity or ignorance are active, that knowledge never becomes wisdom. We develop this knowledge into wisdom by using it unbiasedly without any discrimination or hostility. Finally, the enlightenment that we gain is the final stage or the final goal. So the whole teachings of the Buddha based on these three principles: Sila, Samadhi, Panya. When you compare this with other religions, you can understand. Here, there is no God. There is no belief. There is no faith. But discipline, mental training, and supreme wisdom. That is Buddhism. Now remember, Buddhism does not depend on God. Buddhism does not depend on faith or belief. Buddhism does not depend on commandment or religious laws or religious punishment, but depend on our discipline or our behavior, our character, our moral development. After that, the way how we cultivate, develop, train our mind to maintain our human dignity, to give due credit to our human intelligence, and to make use of this human life in proper manner. So when we cultivate step by step, finally we gain the supreme wisdom and enlightenment. All these problems that human beings are facing all over the world are due to lack of understanding of our duties, responsibilities, obligations, and the human values. Actually, we have not realized the real human values. According to the Buddha, amongst those 31 groups of living beings all over the universe, human beings belong to one group. The Buddha says, human intelligence is far superior to all the other living beings, because many others cannot understand everything. Some living beings use only their instinctive power for their survival and little bit of pleasure. Many others use the worldly power that they gained through the influence of the merit that they have accumulated during their previous birth. They are devas, brahmas, or some other supernatural living being. But that intelligence is not there. Take for instance, other living beings cannot understand what will happen to them after their death. Only human beings can do that. So our intelligence is there. Other living beings cannot prepare for their next life, but human beings can do that. This is the development of the human mind. When other living beings suffer, they cannot understand why they suffer. But we can understand we suffer due to various evil deeds, wicked and cruel and harmful deeds that we have committed during our previous birth. So we are facing the consequences. By realizing this, we try to cultivate, we try to develop our life not to suffer again. Others have no such idea. Again, when we experience very pleasant, very fortunate, very contented life, while others are suffering, facing enormous problems and troubles and miseries and sufferings, then we have a mind to understand we are leading a fortunate life while others are suffering because we have done some meritorious deeds during our previous birth before we come to this life. So we are experiencing the good effect or the good result for the good deeds that we have done. Without wasting and spending the merit that we have accumulated, it is our duty to prepare for the next life also. Only human beings can do that. And now you can understand the human values depend on our understanding or realization, the nature of our life. Again, we have sense of reasoning. Others have no sense of reasoning. We can understand these things are wrong, these things are bad, these things are immoral, these things are moral, these things are useful, these things are useless. That is called sense of reasoning. But others cannot reason out in that way because many of them have only instinct for their survival or little bit of pleasure. So human beings are only living beings in this world who can gain the highest or the supreme wisdom, that is enlightenment. A deva or Brahma or any other supernatural living beings also cannot gain that enlightenment. That means becoming a Buddha. Only human can do that. That is called the development of the human mind. But this development never takes place simply developing our faith and belief and worshipping and praying and offerings. But we had to go beyond that. Because these practices are very common amongst the followers of so many religions. The Buddha did not acknowledge many of those practices as very important religious practices for our development, for gaining wisdom, or the purifications of the mind. Therefore, he has introduced this method by using these three words: Sila, Samadhi, Panya. Just now I mentioned Sila means discipline. The method that we practice in order to train our mind. Because our minds are very stubborn. Therefore, we had to train. If we do not train the mind, we misuse, abuse our intelligence and use for destructive purpose. Therefore, human beings can become the most dangerous living beings in this universe. Take for instance, by using their intelligence, they have discovered atom. By thinking, they can use this energy for constructive purpose for the development of human being. In the end, what happened? By using that energy, they produce nuclear weapons, atom bomb, to destroy the whole world. Amount of nuclear weapons they have produced up to this date, if dumped and collected together and blast at once, not only this world, even the sun and the moons and some other galaxies also will be affected. But everything is done by the human mind. Many more things they will discover in time to come by using that intelligence. If that intelligence is not guided, not trained according to a religious principle, then human beings completely destroy the whole world. That is why religion is important. Intelligence, knowledge, without religious principle, can become very dangerous mental energy. On the other hand, human beings are the only living beings who have a religion. Others do not know anything about religion. Also discovered by the human mind. Religion is not given by the God. Religious principles are not given by the God. By using that human intelligence. They developed humanism. Later, they introduced these principles, humane qualities and virtues. And also incorporated or invited God also to come and occupy, also done by the human mind. The concept of God, also created by the human mind. An American professor, Whitehead, says, first, man create a God. Later, God create the man. The idea is, the concept of God first created by the human mind. After that, they developed this concept and personified, transformed into a figure, also done by the human mind. Then they also introduced that figure, that God create everything. That idea also created by the human mind. That is why the Buddha is not interested about this concept of belief in God, although he does not want to go against this. He was not interested. What he wanted was to develop our human mind by introducing a real religious way of life, very respectable, very noble way, without becoming slaves to religion. Many people who practice certain religion, they become slaves to their religion. They are willing to torture their body to suffer in the name of religion. The Buddha says, it is not necessary for you to suffer in the name of your religion. Not necessary to torture your physical body in the name of your religion. You can use a normal human life. You can lead your life very gentle way, respectable way. Then it will become real religious way of life. You can reduce your rites and rituals and ceremonies and all those external activities. Try to cultivate your mind, your understanding, through this mental training, discipline. That is why he started this with sila, principle. When we observe sila, we not only serve ourselves or protect ourselves, we protect others also. When you put up a big wall or fence to protect your house, you also support to protect your neighbor's houses. So observance of precept or seal or morals or principles is exactly like this. When you create determination in your mind that I don't like to destroy the life of other living being, it is not a law, not a commandment. It is an advice given by the Buddha for you to understand. By knowing this act of killing can create enormous sufferings and worries and disturbances, I stopped killing. through this understanding, not because of the fear of the punishment, not because of God, by knowing that it is wrong, that is called understanding. Then, when we develop this understanding, instead of fear, you create kindness, compassion, sympathy, harmony, all the good qualities you cultivate in the same mind. When you stop all these bad things because of fear of punishment, you never develop any of these good qualities in your mind. No development in that mind. This is the way how the Buddha tried to introduce a religious way of life. He wanted to take out that fear from the mind and develop, cultivate this understanding. So there are two aspects in our precept, in our sila. First, we observe the precept not to harm, not to steal, not to do bad things, that is abstinent, keeping away. That is not enough. You determine not to do bad things. That is not enough. You have to cultivate the other side also. So sila divided into two, charitra and varitra. Varitram is keeping away. That is not enough. We have to cultivate the other side. What is the other side? Now I determine by observing the sila not to kill. That is not enough. At the same time, I had to create this in my mind, my kindness, my compassion, my harmony towards all those living beings. Then completed both sides. Every precept we had to observe in this way. Then we go on developing, increasing the number of precepts. For your day-to-day life, you observe 5 precepts. Because you cannot go beyond that, you have so many commitments, responsibilities, obligations, and duties. In spite of all these things, it is not so easy for you to become so religious. There must be a limit. One day, when you come to know this worldly life creates enormous worries and troubles and disturbances, then you try to reduce all these things. That is called renunciation. Renunciation does not mean simply by shaving head like this and changing your clothing into this. This is only external manifestation. The gadget that we added. But the real renunciation takes place in the mind. Whether you change your clothing or not, whether you shave your head or not, you also can practice this renunciation by reducing too much of your attachment and attachments and craving and selfishness. Then your mind gains wonderful relief. The mind gets the chance to relax. You reduce commitment and responsibilities. Now you can have peace of mind. Then you develop contentment through this renunciation. What is contentment? This is enough for me. If not, this is enough for my family. You don't want to go beyond that. If others also practice the same attitude, then there won't be any problem in this world. Everybody is contented. Then there is no jealousy. There is no anger. There is no violence. There is no bloodshed. No discrimination. No hostility. We can get rid of all the evil forces simply by maintaining this simple mental attitude. What is that? This is enough for me. You are contented. Allow others also to share everything that exists in this world. Why should I crave for so many things? Discipline is there. Then we come to the second one, samadhi. Mental training, mental development, calmness of the mind, we call tranquility. At the moment, we are not experiencing this. Because every second, our mind is jumping, working. Either to reject or to accept. Because all the five senses bring object, external object. Eyes, ears, nose, mouth, body. And the mental image. Six senses, six channels bring objects into the mind. Poor mind had to struggle either to accept or to reject. Must decide. And this is a real mental torture. That is why it is difficult for us to maintain calmness, peace, satisfaction in our mind because of this battle. To avoid this problem, what we do, we fix our mind only on one particular point without allowing all the five senses to bring object into the mind. We stop all these things. Then fix the mind. Senses take the energy, mental energy, and use. Eyes, ear, nose, mouth, body use the mental energy. So when you stop all these things, the mind can reserve the mental energy without wasting for unnecessary things. Why we have fear? So much of fear, insecurity feeling, uncertainty, suspicion, because of the weakness of that mind. Mind is weakened because we have wasted energy for nothing. So if we were to rejuvenate or strengthen the mental energy, you cannot gain this by learning so many things, external things. By reading, learning, you never gain that mental energy. You create more confusion in your mind. So what do you have to do? At least few minutes a day. Allow the mind to relax. If your face is sour, if you maintain long face, then something is wrong in the mind. But you do not know how to handle this. Then you worry. The worry aggravates the situation. Worries never settle our problem. The more we worry, the more we disturb. Not only mind. Worries disturb the whole system. Our organs, our glands, our blood circulation, our heart, our brain cells, neurons, blood cells, later turn into sickness. Those who worry for a long period suffer from so many sicknesses because of those worries. We do not know this. Therefore, worry is not the solution to overcome our problem. If we have cultivated this mind, we do not face this problem, such as worry, because that a strengthened mind gives the solution. So when we are in trouble, we don't know what to do. We go and pray and pray and worship and here and there. Again, we go and discuss with astrologers and what you call mediums. Try to get some sort of solution. Sometimes very hard for us to get the real solution to overcome our problem. We have family problem, physical problems, mental problem, external problem, internal problem, financial problems, thousands and one problems we are facing. But we can get the answer or solution to overcome these problems if we have cultivated and developed and strengthened our mind. Problems are natural. Whether we are religious or not, educated or not, rich or poor, makes no difference. Many of these problems are natural problems, natural occurrences. No one can stop them. But by strengthening the mind, we get the courage to face. Without worrying, without crying, without shouting, without fighting, we know how to face. That is gentleness. If we know how to face our problem without creating disturbances. Religion is needed here again. Your scientific knowledge, your financial support, or your academic knowledge never support, never give anything for you to overcome many of your problems, because these problems were created by the mind. By taking the wrong attitude, only mind can settle the problem. No external support. The mind can solve this problem through religion. Again, you can understand why religion is needed. Religion is not only for us to go and pray. Praying is a very simple thing, anyone can do that. Simply by praying, we won't be able to get rid of our problems. When we pray, we get some sort of relief. Because we think we get some solution from heaven or from God or from Buddha or somebody. So we develop some sort of confidence. Because of that confidence, we experience some sort of calmness. We can reduce our tension and fear. But later, all these rubbish come and occupy the mind. But when we try to overcome our problem through our understanding, not by praying, through our understanding, then we try to find out what is the cause of our problem? We try to overcome our problem without investigating to find out what is the cause of this problem. Naturally, we blame others for all our problems. That is our nature. Sometimes we have created, we are responsible for this problem. The thing that we have done, certain thing that we have said, might have created a cause of this problem. But we are not ready to admit that we are also responsible for this problem. If we can become humble to admit our own weakness, our own mistake, then we tamed our mind to accept. 75% of the tension and the fear and worry you can reduce by adopting this method. Because you admitted your own weaknesses and you knew that you are also responsible for this, then anger, jealousy, suspicion disappear from your mind. Therefore, there must be a practical way, practical method for us to use when there are problems without shouting, quarreling, blaming, accusing, creating suspicion in the mind. We are not perfect. We also make mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. Then why not we admit, or we also make mistakes? Then reduce. We don't create enmity or suspicion. This is the nature of the mind. To avoid all these things, the mental training, development, discipline. As I mentioned just now, without becoming slaves to external objects through the senses, stop all these things for the time being. Close the doors. Allow the mind to relax. Then concentrate. Focus. One-pointedness. Half an hour. When you get up, you feel physically, mentally, very big relief. Because during that period, you have strengthened your energy, mental energy. When mental energy is developed, that reflects to our physical body, especially toward the brain, then we feel very normal. But we have neglected the most important aspect in our religion. We waste our time for unnecessary things in the name of religion. The Buddha did not encourage people to do all these things. You can practice the teachings of the Buddha without spending single cent. Reduce your anger. Reduce your jealousy, reduce your hostility, reduce your discrimination, develop your kindness and understanding. Not necessary to spend even 1 cent. By spending millions of dollars, you cannot gain the good result that you gain by diverting your mind in this manner. To train the mind, to purify the mind, to develop the mind. By spending money for religion and religious activities, you may create more craving in your mind. Through the influence of the merit that I gain, by contributing for this project, may I get the chance to go to heaven and enjoy my life. Are you not increasing your craving? That is not the religion the Buddha introduced. Whenever you give something, the Buddha says, you have to think in this way. I am giving away, I am contributing to to reduce my selfishness, reduce my craving, reduce my jealousy, reduce my anger. That is the purpose of giving. Not to multiply and go and enjoy, then you increase again worldly suffering. So Buddhism was misinterpreted. This is the second stage. What sort of happiness, calmness, satisfaction, peace that we can experience by training this mind? That is the second stage. After doing, when you have completed these two stages, then the pure mind, the mind that we developed through those practices, very easily can realize, easily can understand, because the mind is not deluded, clouded, misled, not blindfolded. Mind is clear. The lens of the mind is clean, can see things clearly. Then we can understand, actually this is right and this is wrong. Others cannot blindfold you, mislead you, because you have developed clear understanding in your mind. After gaining enlightenment, the Buddha said, Aloko Udapadi. Now, brightness arose, appeared in my mind. What is that brightness? Because our minds are in the dark now. There is no brightness in our mind. There are so many dark clouds in our mind. So the mind is covered. So mind is in the dark. But after gaining enlightenment, he said, Aloko Udapadi, brightness arose in my mind, that me can see everything in proper perspective. By using that analytical knowledge, so we always take wrong identity because the mind is in the dark. So supreme wisdom, understanding, we cannot gain without practicing, developing religious principles, without training the mind. At once we cannot jump to gain wisdom, enlightenment, salvation or nibbana. Step by step, we had to develop. By neglecting precept, principles, we cannot train the mind. Without training the mind, we cannot gain wisdom, enlightenment. All are interrelated. That is why the Buddha introduced these three methods, sila, samadhi, panya, three steps to climb. Then, after attaining the highest wisdom, enlightenment, nibbanic bliss. What is nibbanic bliss? Now we have physical and mental, internal and external, so many kinds of sufferings. When the body is healthy, mind becomes very sick. When the mind is healthy, body becomes very sick. Are these two again? There will be a lot of friction, clashes, disagreement, the mind and the body. Then the life suffer in between. There are three things here. Body, the mind and the life, three things. When the body and the mind fight, the life in between suffers. Mind is related to the life. Life is related to the mind. The body gives the shelter for the mind and the life. No one can see the life. No one can see the mind. You can see only body. But body is supporting, giving shelter for them to function. So the attainment of Nibbanic bliss means when that life is completely free from this friction. No clashes, no friction. Then final salvation we experience when we are free from sufferings, pain, worries, unhappiness, unsatisfactoriness, disturbances, fear. Whatever we have, every day we are facing these problems. No one is free. So therefore, we cannot experience Nibbanic bliss by keeping all these problems and disturbances in our life. So by unloading, reducing, then we climb to the peak of our life after this enlightenment, Nibbanic bliss. Life will be free from birth, from sicknesses, from old age, from death, from worries and responsibilities. That is called Nibbanic bliss. That is the aim of Buddhism. Thank you very much. Blessings to all of you. Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba buddhanubhavena sada sutthi bhavantu te bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba dhammanubhavena sada sutthi bhavantu te bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata sabba sanghanubhavena sada sutthi bhavantu te